Okay. So we have seen physical layer and data link layer yesterday. So what is the main responsibility of the physical layer? Before any two systems could talk to each other, they have to be connected physically. Data link layer, the main responsibility of the data link layer is what? The serialization. Apart from that, it has two sublayers, MAC and LLC. MAC is used to identify the device uniquely on the network. LLC provides some higher layer binding. Through that, the receiver could understand the received packet has to be handed over to whom on your network layer. And then what is the main responsibility of the network layer then? That's what we are going to be starting it now. So what is the main responsibility of the network layer? So let's say that network layer. So what is the main responsibility? So here, this is where we are going to be starting up with what? Logical addressing and best path determination. This is the only job of your network layer. What I'm trying to say, so logical addressing. So we have seen in your data link layer, we have seen something called as what? Physical address. And here in layer 3, we are going to be doing something called as what? Logical addressing. So why do we need a logical address? So when you have a physical address using which the communication could be possible, then why do we have to go for identifying the device with the logical address as well? Okay. So let me say like this. I have a PC. And I'm trying to send some traffic through my application, or it could be a ping also. So when I'm trying to say, let's say this is my IP address, 10.0.0.10/8. This is my IP address. I'm trying to send traffic out using an application called a ping. Ping, any IP address. So I'm just going to be saying that what? X. When I say ping, I'm trying to send some sample packets using the protocol called as what? An ICMP, so that I can check the availability of the destination device. When I say ping X, first of all, the sender must be aware of where that X is residing. The X is part of my own network, or the X is part of a different network. That is the first step that I have to be doing it. Why is that so? Because I'm not aware of each and every device that is connected to my network. So if I have to know the device is connected to my own network or in a remote network, first of all, I have to have a mechanism to differentiate that one. So I must be knowing about the destination device is in my network or in a remote network. If it is in my network, then I'll be doing a different process. If it is in my different network, then I'll be doing a different process. So using the physical address only, the communication going to be happening. But with the help of the logical address, I'll be able to determine whether the destination is in my own network or in a different network altogether. How is that going to be happening? So first of all, the moment you're going to be transmitting, you're trying to send some traffic out of your device, it must be aware of what? Okay, let's say like this. Hello? Yes, yes. Yeah, depending on the location or depending on the destination's network, the process is going to be different in sending the traffic. Right? So I just need to know whether the destination is in my own network or a different network. That's the reason we are taking the help of our logical addressing altogether. How this is going to be helping me? First of all, if you would like to send some traffic out of your device, then obviously you have to have something called as a routing table. The routing table is going to be built based on the logical addresses only. So I will be using something called as what? A routing table. So the routing table is going to be populated once you assign an IP address. And the interface is an upstate. Okay. So the routing table for each and every device is going to be populated once you have assigned an IP address for that device. Of course, that interface should also be in upstate. Okay. Now, since I have assigned an IP address for system A, so it has populated a table called as what? A routing table. So how the routing table will look like? So because I have an IP address is in 10.0.0.10/8 as an IP, so because the IP address assigned is 10.0.0.10/8, I know that my home network is 10.0.0.0. So I'm expecting 2 to the power of 24 number of devices to be connected as part of my network. That means if I'm trying to send a traffic to any of the destination which is part of a 10 network, which is nothing but my own home network, I simply need to send an ARP request to get the MAC address of it. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay. If the destination is going to be in remote network, then again I just need to check the routing table. If I have configured a gateway to reach the destination, then I'll be sending an ARP request to that gateway. So that's the logic behind it. So your layer 3 helps us to identify the location of the destination device to whom you're trying to communicate. Based on that, I'm just going to take a call. That do I have to send an ARP request directly to the destination, or do I have to take the help of a gateway to reach out that destination altogether? So if the destination is in my own home network, then I don't need to worry about routing the traffic through different infrastructure devices. So I just need to take the help of the switches alone so that the traffic could be sent and received. If the destination is in a remote network, then obviously I need to take the help of a layer 3 device through which the packets could be forwarded out. Since the destination is in a remote network, I also need to take a call. What would be the best route to reach the destination? You might be having multiple routes to reach the destination, out of which route I'll be taking. That is also going to be part of your layer 3's responsibility. So that's the reason we normally say the layer 3's responsibility is what? Logical addressing and best path determination. Right? And then we are moving on to what? So that's all about layer 3. So we are moving on to what? Layer 4. The layer 4, we normally call it as what? Transport layer. So in transport layer, we are just going to identify the protocol with which the data can be carried from point A to point B. So what physical layer says? It ensures that the data can be transmitted over a physical link. In data link layer, we are identifying the device uniquely on the network. Layer 3, we are identifying the destination is in my own network or in a remote network, and if it is a remote network, what would be the best path to reach the destination. In layer 4, how the data is going to be carried from point A to point B, whether in the same network or in a different network, it doesn't matter for me now. So transport layer helps us to identify the carrier protocol. So mostly, whenever I say that transport layer, the moment I say that they have two different protocols, everyone used to say TCP and UDP. So transmission control protocol or transport control protocol, and then user datagram protocol. That's what two different carriers available in transport layer. So when do you, if at all I have to choose the protocol for transmitting the data from, for carrying the data from point A to point B, I must be aware of the characteristics of each and every carrier. Only then I'll be able to say, okay, this is the protocol I'll be using for this sort of applications to communicate with each other. Okay. So what is the transport layer TCP. So the moment you talk about TCP and UDP, the first question you will be hearing from anyone would be what? What is the difference between TCP and UDP? So in that way, you will be able to understand the characteristics of each and every carrier. So what is the main difference? We used to say TCP as connection oriented, right? Whereas UDP used to say it as what? Connectionless. Okay, what do you mean by connection oriented and what do you mean by connectionless? You have any idea about it? Okay. So before the actual data transmission could be initiated, so first of all, the sender is going to be make sure that the receiver is live and available for my communication. That means it ensures that it opens up a channel and the receiver could listen to the channel, then the data exchange could be possible. Something like a traditional example, whenever we say TCP, is making a call to your friend. If you would like to talk to your friend and you are making a call to him, so it's not that just like that you'll pick up your mobile phone and then talking to him. So you just need to dial, the circuit needs to be established, someone should be picking up the call on the other side, and then you have to ensure that you are talking to your friend. Only then the information could be exchanged. Similarly, when I use TCP, the sender and receiver is going to agree upon certain parameters, and then the data exchange could be possible. In case of UDP, it is not like that. The traditional example for UDP would be what? Sending a mail to your friend. If you would like to send an email to your friend, you just need to, you don't need to ensure that your friend is sitting in front of a PC and he is connected to his mail. You don't need to worry about anything. You just need to send an email. It's his responsibility to open up his inbox and read your email. So in that way, UDP is connectionless. How this connection-oriented communication is going to be achieved? We will take the help of. So the connection-oriented communication in TCP is going to be achieved with the help of three packets. And that's the reason we call always this as what? Three-way handshake. Right? So the three-way handshake process is being initiated to make sure that the sender and receiver could communicate with each other, and then the data exchange could be possible. And what are all those three-way handshake process or three-way handshake is going to be? What are all the packets that they will be exchanging it? Okay. So the first packet, what the sender will be or the initiator will be sending is, we normally call this as SYN packet, correct? So SYN stands for what? Synchronization. So something is going to be synchronized. What is going to be synchronized? And why do we have to synchronize that information? Okay, so let's try to understand first of all what is the synchronization. And let's say like I have two machines here. I have A, I also have B. So since A is going to be initiating a connection with B, so the A will be sending a first packet stating what I would like to synchronize with you. What is that going to be synchronized? Okay. So when data exchange is going to happen between two devices, a series of packets are going to be transmitted. It is not that using one single data, one single piece of packet will help you to exchange all the information I would like to send. It is not possible at all. So they're going to send a series of packets to make sure that the communication is going to be happening. A would like to communicate with B. So A is going to send a bunch of data, a bunch of packets, so that the B would be able to understand what he is asking for. Similarly, B is going to respond back with a response. It is not going to be with one single packet. He will be responding with a series of packets, a bunch of packets. So if that is the case, when A is sending data to B, how B knows that the data has to be or the packet has to be reassembled in the same order. You understand what I'm saying? So A would like to send some data to B. It is not going to happen with a single packet. So A will be sending a bunch of packets as a request. So B has to reassemble everything in the same order A has constructed. Only then B would be able to understand what A is asking for. Once he can understand the request, then he will be responding back with his response, which is also going to be a bunch of packets. Again, A must know in which order it has to be assembled. So what A is trying to do, whenever a packet is being sent, it will start numbering the packet. Okay, so packet number 1, packet number 2, packet number 3, packet number 4, right? And this number is all going to be in sequence. So that when B receives that packet, he can assemble the packet number 1 and then 2 and then 3 and then 4. So that the data could be assembled in the same order how A has been sent. So B can reply back with his own response. When that is happening, B is also going to be sent the packets in sequence. Let's say 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. Then what A will do? A will be able to process the data in the same order how they have received it. Right? So that's the point. Okay. If this is the case, we wouldn't be able to communicate with only, sorry. If this is the case, when A is communicating with B, we are also be able to, it is also possible to make sure, I'm sorry. So I have system A to system B and they are going to be sending the packet in sequence. Assume that there is also one more server, who is asking for, means A is going to open up a connection with T as well. Okay. Now I have A, B, C. Now A is trying to communicate with C at the A is trying to communicate with C parallelly. Is that possible or not? So I'm trying to access Google. I'm also trying to access Microsoft. Both parallelly can be done. If this is the case, when A is trying to access C, already packet number 1, 2, 3, 4 has been transmitted. Now the next packet what I'm trying to send to C would be what? 5. So assume that he is sending 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's say like this. So A has sent some packets to C which was starting from 5, 6, 7, 8. That's the sequence of packets I have sent to C so that he will be able to reassemble and see. So once I have received the response from B, right? Once I have received the response from B, I'm trying to initiate another request with B. Now what will happen? It has to start numbering the packet. 1, 2, 3, 4 I have sent to B, whereas 5, 6, 7, 8 I have sent to C. Because of that, the next packet whatever I'm sending to B would be what? 9. It cannot be 6, 5 or it cannot be 6. Now what B will be wondering, I have received packet number 1, 2, 3, 4. What happened to packet numbers 5, 6, 7, 8? I have not received it. So B would be asking for it because only then he can assure that all the packets has been received and processed. If not, he will be assuming that some of the packets has been dropped. So if I'm going to leave the process like this, then any device could talk to only with only single device. Means if I'm accessing Google, I cannot talk to any other application at all. I cannot talk to any other servers at all. So until I finish the communication with Google, I may not be able to communicate with any other application. To overcome this problem, what TCP has implemented is I'm going to start numbering the packets in sequence. I'm not at all denying it. But the initial sequence number could be anything. So I'm just going to be saying that I'm going to start numbering the packets from this onwards. But hereafter, it will be in sequence. So, when A is trying to communicate with B, it is going to reserve a bunch of numbers and it will be starting with something called as what? Okay, let me say, I'm going to start numbering the packet with 10,000. Right? So, that 10,000, I'm going to call it as initial sequence number that I would like to synchronize it with you. Whenever B receives that information or any of the device receives the SYN packet, they would be able to understand, okay, someone is trying to open up a connection. So he is going to start numbering the packets from 10,000 onwards. So SYN is going to be used for synchronizing the sequence number with the receiver. Now B has received the SYN packet. Now he knows that it will be start receiving the packets from 10,000 onwards. Similarly, B could also be responding for multiple devices parallelly. So it might have received the request from multiple devices, right? So now it is receiving a request from system A to open up a connection. So when he is responding back, he will say that, okay, fine, I got to know that you would like to open up a connection with me. I would also would like to synchronize myself with you. My initial sequence number could be something like 24,000, whatever it might be. So this is my initial sequence number, right? So B is sending a SYN packet. But anyway, B is also going to say, yes, I have received your SYN packet by saying an acknowledgement. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay. So A has sent a SYN packet to synchronize its initial sequence number with B. Now B is replying back with a SYN packet with initial sequence number, as well as an acknowledgement for the received packet. Because of that, we used to call, what is that called? Your TCP as, okay. Now, we are trying to say your TCP is reliable. Because it is sending an acknowledgement. Do you understand what I'm saying? So SYN packet has been sent. Now B is received it and it comes to know someone is trying to open up a connection with me. So if I can respond to that request, then I'll be trying to synchronize my sequence number with him. As well as I will also be acknowledging the SYN packet which I have received to it. Okay. So because of that, we are saying that what TCP is also reliable in nature. Okay. Now sender has sent sin, the receiver has sent sin plus ACK. So that's the reason we say sin ACK packet. The final step of the A would be, the requester would be what? He will simply send an ACK packet. Means acknowledging for it. So once these three packets have been exchanged, so we normally say the connection is established. From this point onwards, they will be able to exchange the data. So request can be sent by A, response can be sent by B, so their communication could be started. Okay, so three packets are being exchanged to open up a connection. Because of that, we call it a three-way handshake. Since this handshake is going to be synchronizing the sequence number between these devices, we also call this process as what? Sequence number synchronization. So these packets are being exchanged to synchronize the sequence number between A and B. We call it as what? Sequence number synchronization packets. Okay. Now, let's try to understand one more thing. So because TCP is reliable, assume that A is sending somewhere around some 1,000 packets. So A is trying to send some 1,000 packets, and it will also be expecting 1,000 acknowledgements because it is reliable. Am I right? So if 10,000 packets are being sent by system A, so 10,000 acknowledgements will be sent by whom? B. So we also know maximum packet size, right? Even though, I'm sorry? Okay, fine. I hear that you are asking for something. Okay, fine. So, even though an acknowledgement is not going to carry some data, because of this minimum and maximum packet size, at a minimum, the packet size should be what? 64 bytes. If it not 64 bytes, then we normally call the packet as what? Runt. So that is an error, the packet will be dropped. Similarly, if the packet's maximum size exceeds 1500 bytes, then it is also considered as an error. We call them as what? Giant, jumbo, depending on the frame size. So at a minimum, 64 bytes of data is going to be transmitted by B. How many acknowledgements will be sending? We know that it is going to be sending 10,000 acknowledgements. Because it has received 10,000 packets, so B has to send 10,000 acknowledgements. Similarly, if B is going to respond back with some number of packets, say these many packets are going to be transmitted as a response, then those many acknowledgements he will be expecting from the receiver. So just because we would like to address what is that called reliability, we are going to double the bandwidth consumption. To avoid this one, so I'm not going to be using as like what? For every packet I receive, I'll be sending an acknowledgement. Why don't we agree upon certain things? Okay, for every 10 packets, I'll be sending an acknowledgement. Similarly, for every 10 packets I will send, I'll be expecting an acknowledgement from you. So that is the process we normally call it as windowing or buffering. So the process of negotiating for how many packets acknowledgement can be sent or received is what we normally call it as windowing or buffering. So how this is going to be happening? Okay. So during this synchronization packet, they will also be negotiating their window size. So window size is nothing but the number of packets what I'm going to be sending, I'll be expecting an acknowledgement. Similarly, once I receive this many number of packets, I'll be sending an acknowledgement. Okay. Assuming that their window size is what? 10. Assuming that what? Their window size is 10. So what is the sequence number we have seen? Okay, so starting from 10,000. So I have sent the packet number 10,000 as well as 10,001 as my acknowledgement. So my data is going to be starting from what? 10,002. So 10,002 to 10,011. So these many packets I'm going to be sending from system A to system B. So first, if I send these 10 packets, I'll be expecting an acknowledgement from B. Now, how B could acknowledge this one? How B could acknowledge this one? He can say that I have received your packet. If that is the case, right? So it could say, B could say that I have received your packets. That's one possible way of acknowledging it. But what if some packets are missing? So instead of when I'm transmitting 10 packets starting from 10,002 to 10,011, what is that will be happening? If all 10 packets are received, if B is saying I have received your packets, then it is good. But if some of the packets are missing, then how this acknowledgement could help to identify the packets which are dropped or which are missed, which are not being received by the B? Now the point is what? The acknowledgement is not going to be simply sent for the packets what I have received. Okay. So assume that the packets are transmitted by system A is 10,002 to 10,011. Let's assume that 10,002 to 10,010 the packets are received, 10,011 is missed. So the acknowledgement process of B is not going to be simply an acknowledgement. It has to acknowledge the packet as well. So instead of sending a simple acknowledgement, B will be sending an acknowledgement for the packet which is being identified by a sequence number. So the acknowledgement can be sent as what? You can say that I have received packet number 10,010. Are you able to follow me? Okay. So the window size is 10. System A is sending 10 packets. If all 10 packets are received by system B, then he can simply send an acknowledgement back to A. If some of the packets are missing, there must be a mechanism to identify which packet got missed. So when receiver is sending an acknowledgement, he is not going to be simply sending an acknowledgement. He will be acknowledging the packet what he has received. So since he is saying that 10,010 is the packet that I have received, system A could send back packet number 11, 10,011 onwards. Right? 10,011, he can send it. This is one way of acknowledgement. Now, my point is, if the last packet is missed out, then it is okay. The last packet is missed out, then it is okay. Assume that I'm sending 10,002 to 10,011, but on system B, I'm seeing that the packet number 10,002 to 10,004 is received, so 10,006 to 10,008 is received, and 10,010 is received. Okay, now how an acknowledgement could be sent? I cannot send multiple acknowledgement. I can send only one acknowledgement. How do I send an acknowledgement? It would be too difficult for me. So that's the reason the type of acknowledgement what has been implemented in TCP is called a forward acknowledgement. So what is that forward acknowledgement? Instead of sending an acknowledgement for the received packet, it will be asking for... So what is the type of acknowledgement? It is called as forward acknowledgement. So normally an acknowledgement would be what? If I receive a packet, I'll be acknowledging, okay, I have received packet number 10. Instead, TCP will say that I'm sending an acknowledgement for the next set of packets what I'm expecting from you. Okay, now let's say like this. If 10,002 to 10,011 is the packet I'm sending it, if all packets are received, B will be sending an acknowledgement for 10,012. So when 10,012 is being received by system A, it could understand that the packet number 10,011 has been received by system B. So I have sent 10,002 to 10,011. Now system B is replying back with 10,012. I think there is an error. So system A has sent the packet starting from 10,002 to 10,011. System B is replying back with the 10,012 as an acknowledgement. So A could understand all 10 packets has been received by B. Okay? So this is one example. Now let's try to understand the another example. What is that? 10,002 to 10,011 is the packet has been transmitted by system A, but whereas system B has received 10,002 to 10,010. Now how an acknowledgement will be sent? I told you that only one acknowledgement can be sent. The acknowledgement will be sent for 10,011. So when system A receives the acknowledgement, it sees that, oh, system B is asking for 10,011. So I have to start transmitting 10,011. But it will not be sending only 10,011. Starting from 10,011, I will be sending 10 packets out. Because my window size is 10, I will not be sending only one single packet. If I have many packets to be transmitted, I will be sending 10 packets altogether. So starting from 10,011 to 10,020, these many packets are going to be sent. Now again, assume that these packets are being transmitted by system A. Now system B has received few of the packets like 10,004, so 10,014 to 10,016 and 10,018. These are the packets has been received by system B. Now how an acknowledgement could be sent? I told you that acknowledgement can be only one single packet. It cannot acknowledge multiple packets. Now the acknowledgement will be like, since I have received 10,014 to 10,016 and 10,018, it is understood that even 10,011 packet has not been received by system B. Do you understand what I'm saying? So the packet, whatever has been transmitted by system A, has been numbered from 10,011 to 10,020. System B has received only 10,014 to 10,016 and 10,018, but not 10,011, 12, 13 or 17, 19 and 20. So the acknowledgement again will be sent as the same. The same acknowledgement number is what I'm sending it. Because I have not received 10,011. So when the acknowledgement has been seen by system A, again it has to send the same set of packets, 10,011 to 10,020. It is called retransmission. So since system B has sent an acknowledgement for 10,011 and my window size is 10, I have to start transmitting 10 packets starting from 10,011. Are you getting my point? Okay. So this is what we normally call it as what? Forward acknowledgement. And that is achieved by, what is it called? Where is my window size? Okay, windowing or buffering. I kept it here. Okay. So TCP is connection oriented, reliable, forward acknowledgement. You also have something called as what? Windowing or buffering. Till this point is clear, right? Okay. Now I'm just going back to something else here. So we know that when a synchronization is happening, these two devices are going to be synchronizing their buffer size with which they can determine for how many packets they send or receive, they will be expecting an acknowledgement. Okay, now system A is there. I'm also going to talk to system B. So, they are going to talk to each other. They will be sending a SYN packet. System A is sending a SYN packet. System B will be sending back SYNACK and system A will be completing the connection establishment by sending an ACK packet. But by that time, they would have also negotiated their buffer size. Assume that. So this is a server. It has a buffer of 100 and this guy has a buffer of 25. Now what would be the buffer they would be negotiated? Whichever is lowest equal. So in this case, let's say that the buffer size of this communication would be what? 25. They have negotiated it. So out of 100, B has reserved 25 for communicating with system A. That's the buffer size. So again, 75 remaining buffer is there, which can be used for negotiating a buffer with one more guy. Assume that system C is trying to open up a connection with system B. So they are negotiating some buffer size. So that buffer, let's say something like 50. So the buffer size would be what? Negotiated is 50. Now one more guy is coming up, and whose buffer size is what? System D is coming up. Right? System D is trying to open up a connection with B, and his buffer size would be negotiated with the remaining. That's the maximum. If D's buffer size is higher than 25, then obviously the buffer size what negotiated would be 25. Okay. Now, what will happen if system D is coming and communicating, trying to open up a connection? Is there any remaining buffer in B? Nope. So what would be the buffer size now? What would be the buffer size? There is no remaining buffer. So what B could do, it can pull some buffer from each and every session, or they can renegotiate their buffer size with the different devices, and it can allocate the available buffer to the new connection. And this is what we normally call it as sliding window or dynamic window. Do you understand what I'm saying? Sliding window or dynamic window is nothing but negotiating their buffer sizes dynamically as and when required. Okay, now let's try to list out what we had discussed. TCP is connection oriented, achieved with the help of three packets, so we call it as three-way handshake. Reliable, achieved through forward acknowledgement, windowing. We also have what? Sliding window. Okay? Do we have these kind of concepts in UDP? No. It is connectionless. It's not reliable. Right? So we don't know anything about anything other than these two things. Right? And one thing we need to understand, because TCP is connection oriented and three-way handshake process, reliability, windowing, all these things, TCP is going to be slow. Okay? Whereas UDP is connectionless and non-reliable, obviously it will be fast. So the data carried over UDP will be faster than TCP. That's the point we are trying to make it up. But because it is non-reliable, what is the use of being fast? Assume that. I'm going to send a traffic using UDP, but I'm not very sure that it may be received by the receiver at all. Then what is the point of using a carrier which is not at all reliable in carrying the data from point A to point B? People may not be using UDP, correct? So, can we use UDP or not?
We can, right?
Okay, it is not. Okay, let's say that one. What, can you tell me an application? We don't want the reliability. Okay. So you would like to watch some live streaming?
Yeah.
Okay. So my point here is, you are streaming some match, right? So you are trying to watch some match. It is going to be transmitted from the server. It is being carried by UDP.
Right.
What if none of the packet you receive it? They won't be read. I'm not at all denying that one. But my point is, if it is not
something that is very important, right?
Okay, so you mean to say that UDP is going to be used for non-important traffic? Okay, see, what is their responsibility? What is their role? Okay, let's say that I have TCP and UDP. I call these two as what? A carrier. It carries the data from point A to point B. That's the maximum they can do. Whereas TCP has implemented with many features, whereas UDP doesn't. So from UDP's perspective, it is non-reliable. From TCP's perspective, it is reliable. So because to achieve this reliability, so TCP has to take care of many processes, it is going to slow down the process. When it comes to UDP, its only job is to carry the data from point A to point B. If you want some reliability features, then you have to address through the application which is using UDP. It is not that UDP applications are non-reliable. Instead of achieving the reliability in transport layer, the application will use a different mechanism. Simply saying that, say for example, if I'm going to use BGP. So BGP uses TCP 179. Okay, TCP as the carrier for establishing the connection. Okay. We normally say that the developer of BGP was a lazy guy, so he don't want to develop his own carrier. So to achieve this reliability and all those things. And because of this, the BGP connection is going to be very slow. Assume, so you have to, exactly. So whenever you are trying to open up a neighbor, you have to wait for this three-way handshake process to happen first. Only then they can start transmitting the neighborship packets.
Right.
That is going to cause some delay. Now what if the BGP is going to be using UDP? Then that kind of a reliability part has to be addressed in BGP itself. That's the point I'm trying to make it. So what, if you're going to use TCP, it is mandated to use all the features embedded with TCP. Whereas UDP is open for everything. If you would like to do something with your application, it is quite possible to do that one. The reliability part, or you would like to implement some special functionalities, then that you can do on the application level. So we are not saying that UDP based applications are non-reliable. We are simply saying that UDP is non-reliable. If you would like to achieve some reliability, that is possible in application level. So you have to ask the developer to write a code so that the reliability could be addressed. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the thing that you need to be understanding on TCP and UDP. There is also one more thing you need to understand on the transport layer, which is called a port number. What is a port number? Anyway, that is known. Okay, let's say that. No. So I'm trying to say, anyway, if application is sending a packet, the receiver could also understand that application, why it has to be identified. And that too in transport layer. Now let's say like this. And this top three layers are very respective to the application to which it is meant for. So it is very, very relevant to the application. Whereas the bottom three layers are very relevant to the networking. Right? When the data is being received by the receiver, after it is being processed at the transport layer, it has to be given to the session layer. So we need to know to which application it is meant for. Only then the processing could be possible on these three layers. So when the packet is reaching the application, it could be knowing that to which application it is meant for. But my point is, when the receiver receives the data, he has to hand over the data after the transport layer to the session layer. So from that point onwards, it is going to be processed to as per the application to which it is meant for. So obviously, I just need to identify the application at the transport layer. And that is going to be done with the help of port number. Logical identification of an application is going to be done with the help of something called as what? A port number. Okay. Now, let me ask you some questions. What is a port number for HTTP? What is the port number for HTTP?
80.
Are you sure? Okay. And how about for telnet? Okay, are you sure about it? How about for DNS? You sure about it?
No, not sure about it.
But actually speaking, that is the correct one. Okay, so I have agreed for the DNS. The port number for the DNS is 53, but again, who me to agree for these things? These are all well-defined port numbers. Anyway, there is a point that I would like to explain you here. So when you have set 53 for DNS, I said, okay, that's correct. Whereas for port number for HTTP is not 80, port number for telnet is not 23. Would you like to argue with me on this? The port number for HTTP is not 80. Why not? So you agree that what I'm saying is correct. That means the HTTP is not having a port number of 80. Oh, you're agreeing for that? Okay. Let me explain you what is that and what is the point I'm trying to make it up. Okay. These port numbers, you have two different ranges and it has 1 to 65,535 ports. Correct? In these port number ranges, you have TCP 1 to 65,535 is also there. UDP 61 to 65,535 is also there. Correct? So when you're simply saying 80, is that TCP 80 or UDP 80? What happened?
Come on, sir.
Okay, now. No, how do I know about it? So you cannot simply 80. Okay, but I agreed for a DNS, right? Why I agreed for that? Exactly. See, that is the point I'm trying to make it up here. Whenever you are talking about a port number, it is mandatory to say the carrier also. Okay. You might be written some access control list in Cisco, right?
Yeah.
So when you're writing an extended access control list to permit HTTP traffic, how you have written? Hope you remember. That is the reason we are saying that access list, 100, permit, TCP, source is any, destination is any, EQ80. This is how we are writing a rule, right? So it is not that simply 80 is being written. You should also say which protocol or which carrier. So whenever it comes to a port number, you also need to mention the carrier as well. So from this point onwards, I'll be expecting whenever someone is asking you, Zubair, what is the port number for HTTP? It is TCP 80, not simply 80.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so that's the point I'm trying to expect. But again, out of these port numbers, client needs a port number and server needs a port number. The client port number and server port number. Server port numbers normally is called as what? Well-known port numbers. So the applications which are being widely used are being standard, means has been given a standard port number. So it could be from 1 to 1023. So the servers can pick up a port number from 1 to 1023, which is very defined. So that's the reason I said for HTTP, the port number is TCP 80. That's the port number they have defined for it. Similarly, when it comes to client, client also needs a port number which is dynamic and which could be greater than 1023. So client will be picking up a port number which would be greater than 1023. The server port numbers are well-known port numbers, and it doesn't mean that you cannot have an application which could run on a different port number than 1023. It could, but you have to define it. So the server port numbers are well-known port numbers which could range from 1 to 1023. Client can pick up a port number which is greater than 1023 dynamically. Right?
Okay.
Yep. Okay. So that's about your transport layer. We will be discussing some more as we start doing some packet capture. So you get little bit of clarity on okay. So when we do the packet capture, certain things you yourself can understand. I don't need to explain you at all. So that's what my goal is. I'm not here to teach everything step by step. I'm going to make you to learn on your own. Okay. Now we are going to talk about what? Session layer. So you just bear with me and... So the information whatever I am giving you is taken from different content and different experiments. Okay. So you may not be getting a single book where you can find everything, but probably you might be knowing about another book called I forgot the name of the book. Exactly, that's the one. Computer Networks. This is the one. This is one of the good book to have a better understanding on OSLAS. I think they have a fifth edition also. This is one of a fantastic book to read. Similarly, if you are able to get something called like what MCSC on Windows, Windows NT PDF. This is also one of the good book to understand OSLAS. But this is only 46 pages. I have seen a very big book actually. Let me check what is that. I have a hard copy of this, but I don't have a soft copy of this.
Okay, I have a hard copy, but that is
Oh my god. But would you be able to get a soft copy of this? I tried a lot, but I couldn't find it.
This one,
Windows NT Server. MCSC, Windows NT Server.
I can get anything as a soft copy. Don't worry. Just send me the proper name of it to the office.
Oh, I see. Oh, yeah. Okay. Then it is good. Because I normally suggest my students to read this book for understanding the packet structure. That will help them a lot when it comes to security. So, but I'm just sharing my hard copy only. Whenever they are coming physically to my classroom, then they will be able to carry this one and they are making a copy of it. Okay. I can share you the ISBN number also. Okay, so I'll share that one. If you get a soft copy, please share it to me also, so that I can share with my students. Okay. Session layer. Is that okay to extend 10, 15 minutes?
Yeah. I have 30 minutes, 40 minutes.
Oh, okay. No, I have to start another class by 9 o'clock.
Yeah, so you
can... Okay, fine. So session layer. The main responsibility of session layer, we normally call it as a dialogue, control, negotiation. What is the dialogue, control, negotiation? It's called as what? Session establishment, maintenance, and termination. Right? So session establishment, session maintenance, and session termination, along with that, duplex negotiation. Right, that is part of your dialogue control negotiation. How a session is going to be identified, session IDs, cookies, all those things we will be using, right? So those are all part of your dialogue control negotiation. A session identification, session establishment, session maintenance, session termination, along with the duplex communication, means a half duplex or full duplex, what kind of an application it is. That negotiation is also going to be happening at your session layer with the help of a process called as what? Dialogue control negotiation. Right? So, I don't have anything else to talk about session layer now. So, as we move forward, we may be talking about little more things. When we do some packet capture and analysis, we will be discussing a little bit of your session layer additional information as well. Okay. So, the next layer is what? Presentation layer. Okay. So, most of the book says that how data has to be presented. That's what the presentation layer's functionality. Something like encoding and decoding, encryption and decryption, compression and decompression. These are all the main functions or main responsibilities of presentation layer. Okay. So encoding and decoding, encryption and decryption. Can you please tell me the difference between these two? Encoding and decoding with encryption and decryption.
Like encryption, like you're trying to convert like a plain text password into like it's not readable. That is encryption. Decryption is like you are getting back to the original.
Okay. Okay, then how about encoding, decoding? In what way encryption differs from encoding? Okay. Now, if I would like to transmit A, this is what I would like to transmit. How this is going to be encoded is A will be converted into ASCII, that ASCII will be converted into binary, and that binary is what we are transmitting. Okay, if I would like to show you some Chinese websites, and you wouldn't be able to read them on your browser until unless you have proper coding, encoding is enabled for it. I'm very sure about the same Urdu. If you're planning to watch some Urdu, if you're trying to browse through some Urdu websites, you need to have that encoding. Only then that would be readable on browser. Why? Because the coding technique for different languages would be different. So normally for English, we use a Western Unicode in your browser settings. That's the coding technique. Something like, you might be heard about the Morse code, right? Morse code. Okay. So this is the one, Morse code. So for every character, they have some coding. For A is what? Did da. For B is what? Da did did did. For C, da did da did. So that's the kind of a coding technique we are using it. Assume that using the Morse code, some data is going to be transmitted. Okay. So I would like to send something called as what? Gopi. This is what I would like to send it. Now, how this will be transmitted? So, first of all, for G, dada did. For O, it would be dada da. For P, what happened? Did, da, da, did. So, this is what encoding is all about. So for I, it is going to be did. Okay, so this is what I'm going to be sending. If anyone can understand the Morse code, they will be able to decode it. Okay, what I'm going to be saying is, how I'm differentiating the encryption, Gopi is going to be converted into, you said something called unreadable ciphertext. It is not the case. Don't ever say that encryption is not human readable. It could be human readable. Say for example, IG pure. So this is what I'm doing it. Okay. So if I'm going to send, what is that called? Gopi. This is the encoding technique I'm using it. I'm sending it over the air so that the other side can decode and they can read what is the text I have sent it. So first of all, I'm trying to protect this communication. To do that one, I'm encrypting it. Because of that, I got an output of what? This is the output I got it. So what is the text, or how do I encode it? For I is what? For I, it is going to be did. For G, it is da did. Whereas for P, it's the same thing. Did, da, did. Whereas for O, it is da. So this is how I'm going to be transmitting it. So the data has been encrypted into IGPO, and that IGPO is what has been encoded and transmitted. If someone is decoding, still they can, someone is receiving and decoding, still they can receive IGPO, but they will not be getting Gopi because they don't know that the data has been encrypted. So what the receiver has to do before he go for decoding, he has to decrypt this data to get the text. Correct, na? Only the decoding is not enough for the receiver. He has to go and decrypt it. When he is decrypting it, he will get the original text. In that way, encryption differs from encoding. Encoding is a standard through which the data could be understandable on the medium. Encryption helps the data to be protected. So it is going to translate it from one format or one text to another text. And the translated text is what going to be transmitted. So if someone on the wire or on the air is going to be receiving it, still they will be able to decode it, but they wouldn't be able to decrypt it. So the original exchange, the original information is not going to be given to anyone else. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay, so fine. So encryption, decryption, encoding, decoding, compression and decompression is part of your presentation layer. Apart from that, it also does something called as dialect control negotiation. What is this dialect control negotiation? First of all, we know what is dialect, right? Dialect is nothing but the slang. What is that slang is all about? Okay, so as English is a universal language, every country is speaking. Correct. But do you think in every country they pronounce, the slang is the same? Okay. Even if you take any language, if you take Hindi, in India, Bihari speaks in a different way, whereas the South Indian speaks Hindi in a different way. Their slang are different. So US accent is different from UK accent, even though they speak the same language. Because we are human, we could understand that and we could easily interpret and analyze it. And we can decode it. It's not a problem at all. We can understand what the other party is saying about it. Right. Now let's say I have Microsoft as a language. And it has, of course, I'm talking from Windows 3, NT, 95, ME, 90, there are a variety of versions are there. Assume that they are from different countries. Windows 3 is a different country, NT is a different country, 95 is a different country, ME is a different country, 98 is a different country. They all speak Microsoft as the language. So there is a possibility that their slang could differ. Okay, so when a new version comes in, they could understand the previous slang as well. Assuming that, okay, let's say Windows 95, the slang number is 1. And Windows 98, they use the slang number 2. XP, they use slang number 3. And then Windows 7 uses slang number 4. And Windows 8 uses slang number 5. Assuming like this. So, XP though it uses slang number 3, it can understand slang 2 and slang 1, but not slang 4 and slang 5.
Right.
Okay, when XP and XP is talking to each other, they can pick up the slang number 3.
Okay.
When XP is talking with 98, XP has to go back and use slang number 2.
Okay.
Only then they can talk to each other. Similarly, when XP is trying to talk to Windows 8, it cannot understand slang number 5, so it will ask the Windows 8 machine to talk slang number 3.
Correct.
So this is what we normally call it as dialect control negotiation. This is part of your presentation layer.
Okay.
Okay. Good. So presentation layer's functionality is what? Dialect control negotiation as well. Means the main responsibility of presentation layer, encoding and decoding, encryption and decryption, compression and decompression, plus dialect control negotiation. Okay. So application layer is what? Is the user interface where the application can feed the data for transmission. So we normally say application layer as what? User interface, where the data can be kept and that could be forwarded out via your network. So I'm just going to stop here because I have not completed my OSL layer. Still certain things I need to feed you, and that we can see on tomorrow's class. Till this point is clear?
Tomorrow.
Oh. Okay. Again, Tuesday, right? Morning in the sense, today evening.
Yeah.
By what time?
Like it's opposite time. Oh
my god, okay. No, no, actually by 7 o'clock I start playing. 7 p.m. So it ends only by 10, 10:15. By the time I have to return back to my home, then I have to take bath, then dinner. Probably by 11, 11:15 I can start, if you're okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, I'll do one thing. When I start from my start from ground, I'll give you information. Let me see. Okay, if there is a change also, I'll inform you.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. No, if it is not possible for tomorrow, then when you can come for the class.
Okay.